Welcome back to a course on measure theory and integration. In the previous lecture, we started discussing the proposition that is to prove the outer measure of an interval is its length. Okay. Initially, we considered a closed finite interval. A closed finite interval in the sense it is of course a bounded. So then we considered that one, and we initially proved the measure. Outer measure of this quantity is smaller than or equals the length, and the outer measure of this quantity is bigger than or equals to b minus a. In order to prove the first inequality, we did not do anything much. We just found an open interval, a collection of open intervals which can contain the given interval ab, right? But when we were in a need to prove the reverse inequality, we considered a countable collection of open intervals covering that one, and with those ideas of Einbauer theorem and all this stuff, we are trying to prove. Okay, we have not completed this part yet, so that is the thing that we will continue in this lecture as well. So in this we were constructing something, and we were able to get a sequence of this form. Okay. Till that we completed. So where did we stop? Therefore, we must get something of this form. Okay. Now, because of the Einbauer theorem that tells us that the quantity that we are considering is a compact one, therefore every open cover will have a finite subcover. So we are going to talk only for the finite subcollection, right? Here, since the collection that we have considered is a finite collection, the process that we are doing must terminate with some interval. The process has to come to a termination at some interval ak bk. Okay, but it terminates only if b is a member of ak bk, because we'll have to cover the entire interval ab, right? So that is, your AK has to be smaller than B, smaller than BK. So with which what we write is summation L of IN, that is the length of all such INs, is bigger than or equals summation I runs from 1 to K length of AI comma BI. Okay. This quantity, length of AA comma BA, means what? Length of AA comma BA is nothing but BA minus AI. So this quantity is what? Only this part is B1 minus A1 plus B2 minus A2 etc. till BK minus AK. Okay, I am just rewriting in the way I need this quantities to be there. Okay, I am writing from the reverse. So first let me write BK, then minus AK plus BK minus 1 minus AK minus 1, and it goes this way till B2 minus A2 plus B1 minus A1. Okay, here I am making a pair of this form, minus of AK minus BK minus 1, then again minus of AK minus 1 minus BK minus 2, and it comes like this. Then at some stage, okay, so it is going to be A3 minus B2. Again minus a2 minus b1 and finally have minus a1. Right? So here I am observing something. What is that? If you notice the way in which we constructed these things tells us that ai minus bi minus 1. Okay, here you may consider a2 minus b1. a2 minus b1 is a negative quantity. From this, it is very clear, right? So from this, a2 minus b1 is very clear. So here itself, it is very evident that ai minus bi minus 1 is also a negative quantity for all I, right? When all these are negative quantities, negation of negative minus of that quantity becomes a positive quantity, right? So minus of this quantity is positive. So we just replace everything with the inequality bigger than zero. So ultimately what we get is summation L of IN is bigger than or equals BK minus AK. Sorry, BK minus A1. Since AI minus BI minus 1, this quantity is smaller than 0. Right? Now, let us observe BK is bigger than B and A1 is smaller than A. So if you, then your BK minus A1 would be what? Which is bigger than B minus A. Am I right? So we shall replace simply BK, which is bigger than B, and minus A1 is bigger than minus A. So this is the thing that we are getting. So with which what we conclude is that summation L of IN is bigger than or equals B minus A. Okay. So actually we'll have strictly greater than, and when we take the infimum, that this would give us the equality. So now let us take infimum. Taking infimum on both the sides, we have infimum of summation L of IN is bigger than or equals B minus A. That is outer measure of AB is bigger than or equals B minus A. Let us consider this as inequality 3, if I am not wrong. So the inequalities, what were the inequalities that we have considered? So this is our equality 1. Okay, so that is our equality. Sorry, inequality 2, right? 2. From 1 and 2, m star of AB is B minus A, which is the length of AB. Okay, we have established the result for finite closed intervals. Okay, now we will have to prove the same for general intervals. Okay. Now let us, okay, did I write in cases? No. So let me consider this as my case 1. Now I am moving to my case 2. That is, if I is any finite interval, okay, so if I is any finite interval, it may or may not be closed, right? So it means it can be open or it may be not closed case as well, right? So in this case, what do we do is that then we find a closed interval some j which is contained in I. Such that for given epsilon positive, L of j is bigger than L of I minus epsilon. Why is it so? If you notice here, we are identifying some closed interval which is contained in I. Okay, therefore it clearly tells us that L of j has to be smaller than or equals L of I. Okay, so if there is any difference between these two things, that is what we take it as epsilon, right? So with which we write this one. Now let us proceed further. L of I minus epsilon is smaller than or equals L of j. Since j is a closed interval, the length is the measure. Okay, by the definition of a measure, if you have something like this, that is, if you have j is contained in I, of course measure of j is smaller than or equals measure of I. This is happening to be true. Okay, and here one more thing. Next, I will consider the closure of this interval I. So I and I closure, so this is the result. So with which what we get, measure of outer measure of I is smaller than or equals outer measure of I closure, right? So when we plug in these ideologies into what, this is smaller than or equals m star of I, which is smaller than or equals m star of I closure. Now if I is your I may be like this or this as well, or sometimes this. For all these possibilities, what is your length? Your length is d minus c. Okay, and your I closure is what? That is the closed interval cd. So what if you look for the length of this I closure, that is also d minus c, right? So whether you consider any of these cases, you are going to get the length of I closure and the length of I are turning to be the same. So that is the ideology that we will make use here. Okay, this is nothing but length of I closure, which is nothing but length of I. Finally, what we have is length of I minus epsilon. In between, we have measure of I, which is again smaller than or equals length of I. Right? So, since epsilon is an arbitrary quantity, right? Since epsilon is arbitrary, we conclude measure of I is the length of I. Okay, so fine. With which what we concluded is that for any finite interval, the outer measure is its length. Okay, now we are turning our attention to some infinite intervals. Okay, that is our case 3. If I is an infinite interval, then given any real number, okay, that real number we represent it as delta here, we can find closed and finite interval J, which is contained in I, with m star of j equals delta. Okay, here what they are trying to say is that you may take here I is given to be an infinite interval. You may take any real number delta. Okay, for the delta, you are able to identify some closed and finite interval such that the outer measure of that interval which you are finding will have the measure value your delta. Okay, you can choose any real number. That is the speciality here. Okay, suppose suppose I take 0 to infinity, this is to be my interval, okay, and I take 1000 to be my delta value, then I can choose 0 to 1000 or 1 to 1001, or if I need, I can choose 1000 to 2000. In this way, I can choose any closed and finite interval. Okay, suppose I have the interval that I chose is 10 to the power 10 to infinity, or minus infinity to 10 to the power minus 1754, whatsoever. Any, the interval that you choose can be anything of the sort. Okay, and you choose some any real number, you are able to identify some interval such that the outer measure of that interval is the number that you chose. Okay, that construction, that identification is always possible. So we have identified something like that. Hence, okay, here what is the case? J is contained in I, right? So measure of I, outer measure of I is bigger than or equals outer measure of J, which is delta. That is, this quantity is bigger than or equals length of J, and that is equal to delta. Okay, from this what we say is that m star of I is bigger than or equals delta for any real number. That is the beautiful thing here. Right, whatever may be the given real number to you, you are able to identify something like that. So what we are saying, the outer measure of I is a bigger quantity than all these things, right? So we come to a conclusion that m star of I is infinity. Infinity is included since we are in the extended real numbers. Right, so here also what happened, m star of I is nothing but the length of I that happens to be the infinity. Hence the outer measure of an interval is its length, be it finite, open, closed, whatever it is, we get this result to be true. Hence the proof, right? The next proposition, I think if I give you the outline of this proposition, you can prove it actually. So we saw this happens to be true for the case of simply and measure. Now we'll have to prove this for the outer measure as well, right? We'll have to prove outer measure is translation invariant. That is, if you have a set A and a number Y, then the outer measure of the set A is same as that of the outer measure of the set A plus Y. Okay. Now, in order to prove the, in order to apply the definition of an outer measure, we'll have to identify some countable collection of sets, and with which we'll have to talk about the infimum and all those things, right? You can just revisit the definition of an outer measure. For any set of real numbers, we'll have to consider countable collection of open intervals that covers the set A. Okay. So, once you collect the countable collection, okay, then we'll have to take the sum of all the lengths of the intervals in the countable collection, and we'll have to take the infimum of that sum. And that is the outer measure, okay. So, here also what? We'll have to identify some countable collection. Okay, let ik with k runs from 1 to infinity be any countable collection of sets that cover A. Right. So, what is A plus Y? A plus Y is the collection of elements. Okay. This is X such that every X is A plus Y, where or for all A in A. This is the collection, right? So, the collection ik plus y, ik plus y, this will cover the set A plus y. Okay. If ik is an open interval, then so is ik plus y. Okay, which implies length of ik has to be same as that of length of ik plus y. So, summation k runs from 1 to infinity, L of ik is same as that of summation k runs from 1 to infinity L of ik plus y. Okay, so taking supremum on both the sides, taking infimum on both the sides, what we get? We get the required result, right? That is, m star of a is same as that of m star of A plus Y, and this completes the proof. Right. Next, we'll see another proposition. That proposition tells us that AN is some countable collection of real numbers. Okay, countable collection of sets of real numbers. So, with which we'll have to prove the outer measure of the union of this countable collection is same as the is smaller than or equals summation of the individual outer measures, right? So, how are we going to prove this? Okay. So, since it is plainly said, what? An is a countable collection of sets of real numbers, right? So, this countable collection may consist of the intervals which are finite as well as infinite, right? So, what if one among them is infinite? Okay. So, it is given So with which, suppose one of an is infinite, then what happens? One of an is infinite, let me say a alpha is the infinite set, right? Suppose if it is so, then m star of a alpha is infinity, right? Therefore, m star of this union of an is also infinity, as well as summation m star of alpha n is also infinity. Okay, the result holds true when one of the set is an infinite set, right? Next, let us consider the case if m star of an is, okay, actually it is star, right? So m's outer measure of all the sets is finite. This is the assumption that we are making. Then, given epsilon positive, there exists a countable collection I with index I of open intervals covering an. So what do we mean by a cover? That is, an is contained in union under I. Okay, so this is happening. Covering means this is the thing. Okay, so here in this collection, we are choosing a particular set an, and for that an we are identifying some countable collections such that the definition of an outer measure holds, right? So for each an you can collect such sets. That is why we have double suffix in this collection. Okay, one is to denote for what set we are taking, and the other index denotes the summation, like the union, the countable union that we are about to take, right? So this is happening, and after this, what is going to happen? We know m star of a is what? Infimum of summation l of I n, such that, or where the collection I n covers a, where n runs from 1 to infinity. That means this countable collection covers a, right? If this is so, infimum, if I have to remove the infimum, what should I do? What do we mean by an infimum? It is the greatest lower bound. Okay, there may be several lower bounds. Among those lower bounds, we are identifying the one which has the greatest value. So if you just simply look at summation L of I n, this quantity is smaller than or equals to m star of a, if I'm not wrong, right? So this is gonna happen. Okay, so here when we take infimum, this becomes equal. So when we don't take infimum, this will be something like this. If I have to remove the inequality, and if I add some very small non-negative quantity to this, this is going to happen trivially, right? So that is the thing that we are about to write here. Here also we have identified some epsilon, we have some epsilon, okay, such that these things are happening, and hence we shall write summation L of I n comma I is smaller than m star of a n plus 2 to the power minus n times of epsilon. Okay, so for some calculation purpose, we are taking 2 to the power minus n along with epsilon. Anyway, epsilon is some arbitrary, very small positive quantity when you multiply 2 to the power minus n with this, it still remains a very small positive quantity, right? So now the collection I n I with I and n, okay, what I'm trying to say here is this is some countable collection. When you make a this is some countable collection. When you make a union of all these sets, that becomes a countable union of countable sets. That is countable, right? So here an is also a countable collection. So for each an, you have a countable collection of sets. You make a union of all such sets, that becomes a countable set. Now for each an, you have a countable collection of sets. When you make the union of these sets, that is also a countable set, right? So we'll have to make use of the countability property here to ensure this collection is countable, right? Since the union of countable sets is countable, and each of this collection, each of this collection covers separately an. So when you make the union of these things, that will cover the union an. Okay, so this collection, here you notice that we have the double suffix, okay? Here also we have the double suffix. This collection covers union an. Hence, the outer measure of this union an can be defined. So, m star of union an is smaller than summation n and I L of I n I. Okay, or let me directly start with the definition. Okay, that would be the better one. So this is infimum of summation n comma I L of I n I. Right? So this is happening. So this is nothing but infimum of summation over n, summation over I L of I n I. So here infimum value is equal to this, so which means the other values can be the same inequality shall be applied here, and therefore what we get is m star of union an is okay. I think just a minute, are we going in a proper way? Yeah. So this quantity is smaller than summation over n, summation over I, L of I n I. Right? So this is happening here. What is this value? This value, summation over I we found, right? So summation over I we found in the equation 1. By equation 1, this quantity is less than summation over n, m star a n plus 2 to the power minus n times of epsilon. Right, and when I take the summation inside, I get summation over n m star of a n plus summation over n 1 upon 2 to the power n times of epsilon. Since epsilon is arbitrary, right, so this can be assumed to be like what? This goes to 0, okay? Since epsilon is arbitrary, epsilon is independent of n, so you can take n outside. So summation 1 upon 2 to the power n, n runs from 1 to infinity. So this would be what? 1 upon 2, 1 minus 1 upon 2. So this happens to be 1. So simply what you get is summation over n, m star of an plus epsilon. Since epsilon is arbitrary, we conclude m star of union an is smaller than or equal summation over n m star of an. So this is what we intended to prove, and we prove this. right? So just pay attention and try to understand the things that are given in the things. Okay, here one more thing that I would like to convey. Here you note that it is given to be a countable collection. Okay, so there is no specification that they have to be disjoint collection. So they need not be disjoint as well. Right? So that's it. Thank you.